This is about a YouTube video. It's only 2 minutes. It's, if you want to look it up, it's called, quote, split brain with one half atheist and one half theist, quote. And you've seen this before, right? Before our talk here.
Yeah.
So what, just to give an overview to the audience about this.
Now let's go to get to the neurology. And one group of patients we have studied is split brain patients or commiserotomy patients. These are people whose corpus callosum has been cut, and anterior commissure and massa intermedia whenever encountered. So essentially you're doing a karate chop right through the head and creating two human beings in one body, in one skull, two spheres of consciousness. Now, many experiments have been done on these people, and I asked myself a very simple question. Okay, you've created two people here. What about their personalities? Do they have different personalities? What about their aesthetic preferences? Does one like blondes and the other like brunettes, for example? One like chocolate and the other like vanilla? What happens? So we tried these experiments, and what we did was we had to first train the right hemisphere to communicate with us. In fact, the right hemisphere can read simple commands, simple words, simple sentences, and then you ask a question and say, point to a box, yes, no, I don't know, because it can't talk. The right hemisphere cannot talk, but it can comprehend simple semantics, simple questions. Left hemisphere, of course, can talk, so you can present boxes, yes, no, I don't know. So we asked, for example, are you at Caltech? And the right hemisphere pointed to yes. Are you on the moon? It said no. Are you in California? It said yes. Are you asleep? It said no. Then I said, are you a woman? And the patient was male. And he pointed to yes. And then started chuckling and laughing. So at least the right hemisphere has a sense of humor. Okay, so now comes the big question. What if you ask, do you believe in God? So I said, do you believe in God? And the right hemisphere went straight to yes, right? Asked the same question to the left hemisphere, yes, no, I don't know. It went to no, right? So here's a human being whose right hemisphere is an atheist and left hemisphere, on the other hand, believes in God. And this finding should have sent a tsunami for the theological community, but barely produced a ripple because it raises all kinds of profound theological questions. If this person dies, what happens? Does one hemisphere... Does one hemisphere go to heaven and the other go to hell? I don't know the answer to that.
But then they said, do you believe in God? And one part of the brain said yes, and the other part said no. And so the question there was, he ended the video with kind of laughter. It's like, what are theologians, how are they going to deal with this? Because is one part of the brain going to go to heaven and one part going to go to hell? What is this person? And so it shows the complexity of the brain and how difficult it is to say that, you know, there's some kind of a spiritual soul attached to this. I mean, how could this soul have some kind of state that's yes and no? So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, the corpus callosum was something that I was really fascinated about in college, and when I was at Oregon State University, no less. This was something that just totally fascinated me, and I spent a lot of time researching it and understanding it. And what you said is absolutely correct. What it is the corpus callosum connects the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere, and you could cut it, and you could show something to the right eye, and the left eye would not know it because there's no communication across. I mean, the best way to think of it is a multiprocessor machine, where for some reason the memory cannot be shared between the two processors. And so, of course, the two processors are going to be working on different concepts and different things. So the question was, obviously, as you said, they asked the person, are you an atheist? And one side said yes, and the other side said no. I mean, first of all, is how many of them did they do? I mean, if they did one, it may have been just kind of a weird thing. Did they do 10? He doesn't talk about it. He only mentions one. But I think here's the issue. Given that here's where we fall back into the old thing. If there is such a thing as there is a soul, if there is a soul and it is interacting with the brain, then actually the brain is an atheist. The soul is the one that has a relationship with God. And I say atheist and theist because that is part of it, right? You know, he was saying, well, which side is going to go to hell? Is one side going to go to hell, the other one side going to heaven? And the body doesn't go to heaven or hell. It's a soul that goes to heaven or hell. So this is a non, and this question has no meaning because you can't cut the soul in half. The soul is presumably a single solid entity in the multidimensional sphere that it is in. So therefore, the question is not, which part of the meat is going to go to hell? Because all the meat is going to end up as worm food, right? I mean, that's all we know that. All the organic matter is going to stay behind. So what ascends into relationship with God or out of relationship with God would be the more eternal part of it, and that would be the soul part of it. So I think that's how you answer the question.
Well, I mean, I don't really have a clear answer from you. I mean, you said, do you think the soul is attaching to a part of the brain, and so it only attaches to one part, not the other part?
Yeah, I would. Well, maybe not. See, that would be something that I would. I go back to my old days in college, and I would love to study that more and see if there is some way we can tie that in together. But just as I don't think that your salvation comes from your emotions, I don't think your salvation comes from your. You can logically get to the point where your soul understands and embraces. So let me go a step further here. One of the issues about logic is tying logic and reason to faith, and which is what I do all the time, is you can take someone so far logically to the point where it all makes sense that God rose from the dead and all that, but innately in them they have a rejection of the facts. And I always say to some of my friends, I said, don't let the logical conclusions that you arrive at force you to abandon the logic.
I don't know. I would argue the opposite, that people are more predisposed to believe in God.
And it may too, because that's also bad, right? If you're predisposed to believe in God and it's the wrong God, or it's, you know, then you're again. So I would say,
the reason why I think is just because as creatures, you know, we're afraid of the dark and we believe in ghosts because, you know, something moved that bush over there and we didn't see what it was.
Maybe it was
a ghost. And I think I had a dream of somebody who departed. It must be ghosts. And so, I mean, that's why I think it's more natural. And
but we agree on that. I think
it takes the education to override that.
I'm saying both of these are, in other words, if you believe in God because in spite of the logic, or you disbelieve in God in spite of the logic, you're still doing the wrong thing. Now, of course, for your listeners, I have not provided any evidence for either of this. You'd have to go read my book or listen to some of the last of previous debates that we've had. But so I'm not providing evidence in this. This is just a philosophical discussion here.
Let me talk about something. You brought up this idea. It's like you said the brain is like a multiprocessor computer. And that's exactly what I agree with and what I'm trying to say. So like if you had a computer that had, let's say, 1,000 cores in it, it's all trying, let's say it's a learning computer, and it's trying to figure out what the world is all about, it's going to be crunching in unity to try to come up with an answer. And if you had half of those cores separated from the other half, now you have two computers, and the two computers are going to learn differently because they're looking at different inputs at different times. And so basically they're going to have a different answer. They're going to be at different states. And then if you chopped up those two to two more, so you had like four of them or eight or 16, all of these little computers, because they're learning from different stimuli and different results, they're all going to have a little different idea. And so basically we say, we built a mental image and we say this computer is basically the sum of all the parts. And of course if you break it up, you're going to have two computers or three computers. So that's the idea with the brain. We say the brain, the mind arises from the brain. There is no one person's soul in there. So of course, if you chop it into two, you're going to have two different ideas. So it makes sense if the mind comes from the brain, you're going to get these different ideas with this kind of idea. But that's why I don't understand still, if there's one soul,
I'm trying to see if the analogy is always difficult. The multidimensional analogy is the best one. Basically, yes, the computers are in three-dimensional space or four-dimensional space, and the soul or the controller of the computer is in multidimensional space, in the fifth-dimensional space, and it overrides all of that. So basically, you've got the computer and you've got the user. So the computer is your brain. The user is your soul.
No, I'm not talking about a user. I'm talking about a, let's say, a self-learning.
Typing on the computer is the soul.
Okay, but I mean,
but
we need to talk about more advanced computers where they have self-learning computers where they can just start from scratch and observe the world and build up from what they observe and learn.
And I think that will happen, but I still don't think that makes them a soul. They're still a computer. They're still a machine, right? And we're back to this thing. I believe the user is the soul. The user is you. The computer is just the way you communicate with the world.
Well, so they have robots now that will learn, like even learn how to walk. They don't even know how to walk, and they just try different things, and they learn how to walk.
Right, so they figure it out. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And they have all these kind of funny walking patterns because, you know, it's good enough.
But all we've done is we've said, okay, so the computer now is more self-sufficient.
But there's also no user in it. It's just figuring it out. And then if you put two of these devices on the ground, they'd probably come up with a little different idea because they're just learning.
And that's what we call insects, right? The insect is the meat machine with no user, without no soul. Animals.
Well, it depends on what you say. I mean, some people say that all the animals also have souls. You know,
well, so yeah, but I'm trying to give you an example. But most Christians say that the insects don't have souls, and of course the Hindus think they all have souls. So yeah, I don't want to get into that theological discussion. But I'm trying to give you an analogy here. Yeah. So
We're out of time here. So just I'll give you some 30 seconds to try to summarize it then.
Okay. So the analogy here is the multiprocessor computer that is self-learning, the self-driving car. These are all the equivalent of insects or the equivalent of meat machines. And I'm saying human beings are given a soul by God uniquely and independently, and this is a multidimensional entity that science tells us does exist. And all I'm saying is there's an intelligent life and there's multiple dimensional existence, and your soul is in that multiple existence. And when you die, when your body dies, your soul continues. Just like when the computer dies, I move to a new computer.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things I got to ask you this, I guess, because it just doesn't make sense to me to say that God gives people souls. I mean, you know, if you know about the miscarriage rate, the natural miscarriage rate, it's so high. It's I don't know, it could be even as high as 80% or something. A lot of women have miscarriages without even knowing they're pregnant because it happened so early. Why is God giving souls to all these aborted babies?
The question you have to ask yourself is God giving a soul? Or is he assigning a soul or giving, you know, how? I don't know, that there's no, the Bible doesn't really talk about that.
But why even assign a soul, or why even put a soul on something that's not even going to be born?
Well, because remember, if you understand Christian theology, the reason why you're created is not for you to be on earth. The reason you're created is for you to enjoy God in all eternity in his presence. To glorify God in his presence. And for that, some people don't have to be on earth. They don't have to go through the earth.
Why not?
Part of it. Some people do.
Why not?
That's a good question. I think you could ask God, but I would say that the reason earth is similar to boot camp. We're being refined. Do we have free will in heaven? Yes, we better have free
But there's
will.
No boot camp
so
for anybody
get
that
to the point?
There's no boot camp for anybody that dies in a miscarriage before they're even born.
Perhaps because they didn't need it. That's my point.
Why would they not need it? But you can't. It doesn't make sense to say, well, they would have turned out to be a perfect person because
you're pushing the envelope, and I don't want to be. I'm not spouting this as theology. So
yeah,
listening to this. This is
I understand.
Not
yeah,
I'm saying these are possible answers. You know, I don't want somebody going, oh, well, Neil says. But here's okay. So there are multiple ways to look at it. One.
Well, we might actually.
God does not assign a soul. If God does not assign a soul, if the baby is not being viable, that's one possibility. The second one, he does assign a soul, but that soul does not need to come to earth to be refined, and that soul can go immediately into existence with him. And then you could say, well, why does he even have to go through that cycle, which is why that's a question. I mean, did you have to even be born? God could create a soul on his own to have a relationship with him. So these are good questions, and I think they are theological questions, but I don't think that the fact that we don't have an answer to them means that our solutions are wrong. Again, to your listeners, I'm not providing evidence here. This is a philosophical discussion.
Okay, so we might get more into that in a bonus material later, too. I have some more related questions on that. All right, ready for the next one?
Sure.